The FCC is, of course, the place where we work on the first draft of history. That's why that a lot of correspondents and journalists aren't here today. But it's a fantastic place with journalists, correspondents, lawyers, and it of course was the place that our two speakers today met for the first time. Daniel Ivery, I think the journalist of the future, in the way that he's managed to do the sort of work he's been doing without the backing of an institutional media organization. And Will Giles, another longstanding member and propper up of the lawyer part of the bar, of the main bar. They met here 2 years ago? 2 years ago, as you do in the FCC, you know, journalists looking for a story, non-journalists got a good story to tell, and they worked so well together that they came up with this book on one of the more interesting cases in Hong Kong history, on one of the more interesting characters to come out of Hong Kong in recent years. And we're very pleased and proud to have them here to speak today and talk about that book. I believe they will be both speaking. Will be speaking first on money laundering, and then Dan on football ownership rules in Hong Kong. And then after that, they will be very happy to take questions. Without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Will, I think, who is speaking first, and he'll be speaking from his seat. Please, round of applause for Will, please. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Douglas. It's an absolute pleasure to be here, a bastion of free speech, and let's try and keep it that way. Some of the things I'm going to say are quite controversial, and some people won't agree with them. So please come back at me. Let's have a good debate in the spirit of the FCC and Hong Kong. I'm very lucky as well, because I've got Kevin Egan here, who can help me with the law if I go wrong. And we've also, Kevin was involved for Carson Yeung in the district court trial. And we also have the senior prosecutor here, John Reading. So we're expecting some fireworks at the end. The rise and fall of Carson Yeung, it's only the story so far, because as we know, Carson has lodged an appeal from his conviction to the Court of Appeal, and then there will no doubt be a further appeal should that go against him, or the prosecution may have grounds to bring what's called a case stated if they fail. And the fall is also incomplete for the simple reason that Carson remains the single largest and apparently controlling shareholder of Birmingham International Holdings, the owner of Birmingham City Football Club. And Daniel will describe some of the effects of Carson's plight on his beloved club. So in football terms, we're not even at half-time, and you'll have to excuse some of my lame football metaphors, but you'll understand the football and legal stories are linked. So why is Carson's case so interesting? It allows us to examine the law, Section 25(1) of the Organised and Serious Crimes Ordinance, often referred to as OSCO. And this was the first time this law was applied to what might be called a tall poppy. Previous convictions under this law had included the illiterate public housing tenant who was convicted of laundering $6.7 billion through her accounts, for which she received the occasional payments of $4,500 a month for her housekeeping. She was in prison for 10 years. Or the case in the young mainland 22-year-old dropout who was jailed for 10 and a half years for laundering 13 billion Hong Kong dollars, both cases receiving little attention as they were of little or no shock or publicity value to the government. Those cases do demonstrate the masterminds that benefit from the laundry are frequently never brought before the courts. And I'll be arguing the same could be said in Carson's case, as we shall see. Having said all that, please don't mistake me for some kind of apologist for Carson Yeung. We, and Daniel in particular, uncovered many, many items of questionable conduct, all of which seem to have escaped the authorities' gaze. Our only interest is in the legal process against Carson and how the results of that process affected a popular professional football club, Birmingham City. I only ever met Carson once. It only lasted a few seconds. I knew he would be at the same dinner as Kevin Egan at the Four Seasons for a Birmingham International Holdings dinner. And I'd lined up a photographer, hoping for a shot for the book. But Carson has a sixth sense about cameras. And as soon as he smelled the camera, he was off, straight down the wing. He's never seen anyone move so fast. From our knowledge, he's only ever spoken to the press three times in the last 2.5-3 years. And one of those times was with Daniel Ivery outside the district court, in which he showed great interest in a supporter's view of his football club. So let's have a look at the law. It's section 25.1 of the OSCO, and it's really only the seven words, knowing or having reasonable grounds to believe. They're the only words you really need to concentrate on for the next few minutes. And you'll see our logo there for our book in the bottom left-hand corner, the football pierced by the barber's scissors designed by our great designer, David Turner, who's given us so much of his time. The logo signifies the puncturing of Carson's football dreams under what we would call the second limb. The second limb of the law is the having reasonable grounds to believe. The first limb, the knowing limb, I call it the prosthetic limb, because the prosecution doesn't really need it. It could take it off and throw it away, because all they ever really need under this law in Hong Kong is the second limb, because the knowing, they don't need to prove the knowing under Hong Kong law, as we'll see. So the connection between Carson's hairdressing career and his downfall is not just symbolic, as in David's great design. The district court judge Yao found that Carson had lied about his income from his various salons, which provided additional evidence to convict him of the money laundering charges. And if we get time, I'll be asking Kevin why Carson actually went into the witness box to give evidence, because he had the option as a defendant not to give evidence on his own behalf. The trouble with the definition of the offence under Section 25.1 as interpreted by the courts is that the reasonable grounds to believe are not the defendants. They are of a reasonable, right-thinking member of the community. But in reality, the judge substitutes what he sees as reasonable grounds to believe. And crucially, the prosecution under the existing case law does not have to prove or even allege a predicate or underlying offence as the source of the proceeds in question under this law. In his judgment in Carson's case, Judge Yao confirmed it was not his function to speculate what any underlying offence might be. He was simply concerned with the reasonable man himself and whether he had reasonable grounds to believe that the money in Carson's accounts, which he dealt with, represented the proceeds of an indictable offence. In Carson's case, the prosecution proved the offences to the judge's satisfaction by presenting a succession of witnesses who gave evidence of the large sums of money passing through his and his father's accounts, about $720 million over 10 years. Coupled with the evidence from the accounting expert, Mr. Rod Sutton, that the dealing with the money had all the hallmarks of money laundering. Now, I note here that Rod Sutton's firm, FTI, has sued the government for over $6 million for what it says are fees due for its services in assisting the prosecution case. So just think about that for a minute. $6 million for fees for an accounting expert to consider things like money flowing through the accounts, hallmarks of money laundering, but no investigation of the actual source of the funds. Those people who deposited the money in Carson's accounts were never part of the charges. Isn't that incredible? Is that a proper use of public funds? So in his judgment, Judge Yao said the following. He said the prosecution did not seek to identify any underlying indictable offence, and they do not rely on the knowing limb, the prosthetic limb of the offence. And in convicting Carson of the first charge, he said this: I find that a right-thinking member of the community, when looking at the movement of funds in account A and all the surrounding circumstances mentioned above, would have reasonable grounds to believe that the money being dealt with through the account represented wholly or in part, directly or indirectly, proceeds of an indictable offence. I therefore find the defendant had reasonable grounds also to so believe, and I convict him of charge one accordingly. And he went on to similarly convict Carson on the four other charges. And as the judge himself said, the conviction was based on the surrounding circumstances. The evidence was by definition only circumstantial. Now, I believe that this law slipped through the net, or in Carson's case, the side netting, when it was enacted in 1995 to bring it into line with the Drug Trafficking Recovery of Proceeds Ordinance. It stretches most reasonable lawyers' credibility that someone can be convicted where no underlying indictable offence is proved. And even if the defendant even correctly believed the proceeds were not the proceeds of an indictable offence, the judge can still substitute his or the reasonable man's own belief that he should have done and convict him. So let's look again at the evidence against Carson that District Court Judge Yao found sufficient to convict him. There was a series of witnesses from stockbroking companies who confirmed that the large sums of money passed through these stockbroking accounts. There were some deposits by some dodgy individuals, and the evidence from the expert, Mr. Sutton, that the accounts and Carson's use of them had all the hallmarks of money laundering, and that evidence apparently cost the public up to $6 million. That was it. No prostitution, no drugs, no protection money, no underlying offence ever proved or even suggested. And there was another interesting episode from the trial which would seem to demonstrate that the way this law operates doesn't pass the smell test. It was around halfway through the trial, and Graham Harris, SC, Carson's counsel, we call him the Edwardian gentleman because of his magnificent style, his brightly coloured ties and socks, and his eloquent speeches. And he was in the middle of a stay application, and these were applications he made on behalf of the defendant, who he said was being unfairly prejudiced by the conduct of the investigation and prosecution. And the Edwardian previously cited the lengthy delays in investigating, then prosecuting Carson, which resulted in documents at banks and stockbroking firms being destroyed in the ordinary course of business to the detriment of the defendant. Anyway, on this occasion, the Edwardian handed up a list of names to the judge, and he gave a copy to the prosecution. He explained those were the names of the various depositors of the funds into Carson's accounts, and he questioned why the police and prosecution had not investigated those people to ascertain the real source of funds. And he was apparently inferring that the failure to investigate the depositors was prejudicial to his client. Now, apart from the questionable tactic, in that it's difficult to see how it would benefit his own client's case, it was also considerably risky given some of the names on that list. But what isn't generally known is that as a result of the Edwardian's surprising move, many names on that list were in fact arrested as a result of this episode. And presumably this was some kind of backside covering by the prosecution authorities. What the incident would appear to confirm is that at no stage prior to those arrests had the police or prosecution made any attempt whatsoever to investigate the actual sources of the funds in Carson's accounts. They were content to put the cart before the horse, just bring the charges based on the proceeds of the hypothetical crime. And in fact, this law encourages this lazy approach by police and prosecutors. They do not need the first limb. They never need it. It's the prosthetic limb, as I say. They may as well prosecute always solely on the basis of the second limb. But it goes even further than this. because of the incredibly wide ambit of financial transactions potentially covered by this law, there is an increasing tendency by the Department of Justice to add money laundering charges to indictments when financial wrongdoing is alleged as a catch-all in the almost certain knowledge that they can secure a conviction under the second limb. And so we come to the district court. And there's a rather unfair joke in legal circles that the last time the Edwardian kept a man out of prison in the district court was when he was prosecuting him. It's unfair because although the Edwardian's record of acquittals in the district court is abysmal, he is certainly not alone in seeing almost all of his clients convicted of the charges against them. And you may remember that in 2010, Clive Grossman, a former deputy chairman of the Hong Kong Bar Council, claimed the high conviction rate in Hong Kong was probably approaching that of North Korea. Well, North Korea hasn't changed, and neither has the district court. A steady 90% of all cases in the district court result in guilty verdicts. This, of course, includes guilty pleas, but it's still very much a higher rate than similar courts in England and Wales, Canada and Australia. In Hong Kong, the prosecution has the added benefit that it can elect the forum for trials of indictable offences. Is it therefore any wonder the Department of Injustice elects for trials in the district court? So why is the conviction rate so high? One aspect which I believe should be considered is the background and the experience of the district court judges. Of the judges who preside over criminal trials in the district court, around 25% have only ever acted as prosecution counsel before their appointments as judges. They inevitably consider cases through what we might call the prosecutor's prism in arriving at their verdicts. Judges are appointed by the chief executive of the HKSAR, the under fire CY Leung, on the recommendation of the Judicial Officers Recommendation Commission, which is composed mostly of judges and barristers and whose meetings are, unlike other jurisdictions, secret. So my final observations as a result of this case and our investigations are: the judicial definition of this offence is so wide that it could cover normal business conduct, which is practiced thousands of times a day in Hong Kong. For example, mirror banking, where a person might deposit yuan with the money changer he's used for 20 years in the PRC, who then deposits Hong Kong dollars in that person's account in Hong Kong. The recipient of such funds could not verify the origin of those funds and would therefore be vulnerable under the second limb. And I would simply add there that that type of transaction has been the basis of Hong Kong's commercial success over the last 30 or 40 years. Secondly, the conviction of the tall poppy, Carson, under this draconian law was swiftly hailed by the Hong Kong government to justify its commitment to international standards in combating money laundering. Jackie Liu, Principal Assistant Secretary for Financial Services in the Treasury, shortly after Carson's conviction said, "Successful conviction of recent cases shows our determination and efficacy among law enforcement agencies and financial regulators in combating money laundering." Thirdly, those charged under the second limb have next to no chance of being acquitted in the district court, given the judicial interpretation of this bad law and the institutional bias in favour of the prosecution, who can elect a trial in the district court. Fourthly and finally, next time you hear the phrase, "the independence of the judiciary," this phrase is defined by the government on its website as constitutional independence and independence of outlook. You might want to question this other second limb. Can some of those judges really have independence of outlook, given their backgrounds and the method of their appointment? My final word is, when you hear a result of a survey that Hong Kong is the world's freest economy, You might question that when you think of the potential consequences of accepting funds from a new customer in, say, Birmingham. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Will. I should start by introducing myself because I'm not a Hong Kong resident. My name's Daniel. I come from Birmingham, and for my sins, I am a Birmingham City fan, which is my primary motivation for writing this book. To set the scene, I first became involved with Carson back in 2009. On October 16th, 2009, Carson Yeung, flanked by his confidants and associates, Peter Panu, Sammy Yu, Vico Hoy, walked into my football club, Birmingham City, and their stadium, St Andrews, to take control. It had been a long 2-year battle to do so. And in front of the press, sat much like this, he was really happy to do so. He told the assembled press that he had £40 million to spend in the transfer window that was upcoming. And as everyone sat there in stunned silence, thinking, did he really just say £40 million? He said, and the same again in the summer. To Birmingham City fans, that was an amazing thing to happen. We are a club that has never really done anything, never really been anywhere, and here was a man who was going to take us to the stars. There's an old aphorism that if something seems to be too good to be true, it probably is, and in this case it was as well. As to why that is the case, you have to go back a little bit further. Carson was first involved in trying to buy the club in 2007. The incumbent board at the time, a gentleman by the name of David Sullivan, and two brothers by the name of Ralph and David Gold, owned the club, but it wasn't going really anywhere. They'd been in charge for 15, 16 years, and they were bored of us, to be frank. And I think the fans were bored of them. And we were getting to a point where, although they weren't using tear gas on us, we were definitely revolting. So David Sullivan decided that he wanted to sell the club, and he got in touch with investment banker Seymour Pierce, a gentleman by the name of Keith Harris, and said, can you find me someone who will buy the club? Keith Harris came up with Carson Yeung. Carson came along and he made an offer, bought 29.9%, which I'll come to is a very specific number, with the promise to buy the rest by Christmas, a promise that didn't happen. He broke. It took him 2 years to come back with the money to buy the rest of it, and by this time, David Sullivan, who's never been known to be a shrinking violet in the press, had made his views known on many occasions of how unimpressed he was by Carson's lack of forthcoming with the cash. So when Carson came back and said, yeah, actually, I do want to buy this football club, David Sullivan, as he would, said, well, I'm not sure I trust you, so it's going to cost you £1 a share, which was roughly three times what the club was worth. I believe he was doing it in a case of trying to get rid of him. To which Carson replied, go on then, well, I can do that, £1 a share, no problem. So David Sullivan again is like, well, cash? I have no promises here, I want hot, cold, hard cash. Again, Carson was like, yep, I can do that, no problem. £81 million he spent on Birmingham City. £81 million for a club that was worth, at best, maybe 30. We called the book Haircuts and League Cups, not just because Carson was a hairdresser, but also because haircut's a very specific term in financial terms. You take a haircut on a loan, you take a massive drop in it, you have to receive less, and Carson's doing that right now. The club is still up for sale at $400 million Hong Kong dollars, which is about 30 million quid. Loss of about 50 million on what he's bought, what he paid for it, and no one's interested because that is still three times what the club is worth. When Carson bought the club in August 2009, he was forced to take the owners and directors test, as all people who are going to become prospective owners or directors of a football club in the UK, in England have to do. It's a simple one-page self-certification form. He asks you if you've had any offences of dishonesty, if you've been sanctioned by any other sporting body, if you've been involved in any bankruptcies. Simple stuff, really. Yeah. No, and Carson, obviously, hadn't been convicted of any offence of dishonesty at that point, although he had been convicted of 14 counts of failing to disclose the number of shares he had in 2004, something that's not actually a crime in the UK, so it didn't count. He never been bankrupt, never been sanctioned by a sporting body, so they let him straight on, no problem. We get to now, 2014, and if Birmingham City fans were revolting before, they're downright disgusting now. So much so, there's a little story here, and my good friend and colleague David, our graphic designer, was involved in this, heavily involved. Back in February, things had gotten to a point where Carson was just about to be convicted, fans wanted the club to be sold, but they couldn't get anyone to listen to them. So I had been over here and I noticed there was a shop on Hollywood Road called Goods of Desire. I don't know if any of you know it, but they have these slogans on their t-shirt which say, "Delay no more," which I'm told means something completely different in Cantonese. And I happened to mention this on my website that, you know, it's quite a good campaign slogan, bearing in mind it means something different. And my friend David ran with it. He's an amazing designer, came up with a full campaign logo and banners. So February, we played a home game against Derby County, I'm going to say. I think it was Derby. And the fans proudly took this flag into the ground and displayed it, "Delay no more," with Cantonese characters beneath it, the forbidden four words. You can imagine how that went down. I'm told that the acting chairman, Peter Panu, who was a former barrister here, I understand. Yeah. And cop, yes. Of course, he was suspended for 3 years. He was most displeased by this and made his displeasure quite well known with the staff at the club. And then a month later, tried to sue me for it. He failed. Stepping away from that side issue, you can tell that the fans are not happy. Their club is on the slide. We play in the second tier, and we only do that because of a miracle 94th minute goal in the last match of last season. We are probably going to be relegated this season. There is no sign of investment. There is no sign of any hope. And I think the fans are now at a point where it's become so long and so ongoing, I think they've lost hope. Why? Now, I'm like Will on this. I don't just look at this thing and get angry about it. I want to understand why this is the situation. As I said to you, back in 2009, Carson had to take a test by the football club and he passed it. Only three people have ever failed it and one of them beat it on appeal. I understand, though, he might be in a spot of bother now, a gentleman by the name of Massimo Cellino. When he took the test in 2009, if the Football Association or the Premier League or the Football League had done any investigation at all, they'd found out something completely different to what he wrote on his form. In a past life, I was a youth worker and I worked with children. And before I started working with children, you have to take a Criminal Records Bureau check in England, which is like the same sort of thing, you know, have you got any convictions, have you done this, have you done that? The extended version, which is for when you work with children, they get in touch with the police and see if there's any current ongoing investigations into you. If the FA or the Premier League had got in touch with the Hong Kong authorities in 2009 and said, "Have you got any investigations involving dishonesty with Carson Yeung?" They'd have said, "Yes, we're currently investigating him for money laundering." Now, again, like Will, I firmly believe in justice, in innocent before proven guilty, but I also believe that if you've got someone who's looking to buy a football club, who has a history of concealing how many shares he owns, who's got a history of using nominee accounts, then you're entitled to ask them a few more questions as to what their purpose, their ambition is, and you're entitled to ask them maybe to put up something as a security in case it does all go wrong. I'm going to leave you with the thought that this happened to my club, Birmingham City, and we might get out of it soon, we might be sold. I don't know how many people here are fans of other football clubs, but until changes are made, this will keep happening.
Thank you. Thanks very much, Daniel and Will. And I forgot to mention earlier that I learned another little piece of information about Daniel, the journalist of the future, which made me empathize with him even more, which is that after having made a fantastic effort in journalism with his website and now this book, I can now welcome him to the world of editing financial news real time, and you have my deep empathy on that. If anyone would like to begin a discussion, give us some feedback. We've had a lot of different points here. If you could just raise your hand, and someone will come over to you with a microphone. We've got about a gentleman at the front.
Hi there, Matthew Williams. This is a question for Daniel. As a fan, what do you think was the purpose of this purchase? Was it money laundering, or was it to get involved in the gambling side of things? You know, when's the first corner going to be taken, et cetera, et cetera? Because even if they stick 80 million quid in, at some point they've got to get that 80 million back. And this is as a West Ham fan, who of course now have the benefit of Golden Sullivan.
Firstly, I'd like to commiserate you on having David Golden, David Sullivan, and Lady Brady, as Baroness Brady of Knightsbridge, as I believe she is now, in charge of your football club. I think it would be dangerous to second-guess Carson's motives. I would say that having met him, having spoken to him, he's definitely a football fan. And I think that there was definitely a case that he wanted to own a football club, and he revelled in the attention that brought. He loved going to games, he loved being involved. But I would also add that, and this is public information, it was announced to the Stock Exchange last November that $184 million were loaned to the club by Carson Yeung, but they don't know where the actual source of those funds were. And the way I'm led to believe it happened, from speaking to contacts within the club, is that Carson would phone up the club, or one of his right-hand men would do so, and they would say, okay, you need some money, this is a friend of mine, he owes me some, so he's going to send it to you, you pay me back whenever you can. No paperwork, nothing. That to me sounds fishy.
Can I add something that might help? During the course of the trial, Carson gave evidence that what he hoped to do was, in due course, introduce players from China who were of the requisite standard to play for Birmingham City and then send them back to China so they could develop the game back there. That was the evidence he gave. Now, you believe him, you don't believe him, but that was the evidence he gave. The other point I'd make, and I don't want to say too much about Carson's case because it's sub judice, and we don't know where it'll go, but there is this point. If you are a money launderer, I would have thought one of the last things you needed to do was to draw attention to yourself. And being a Hong Kong Chinese buying a Premier League football club in England, not a very good way to remain discreet.
Could I just add this? We spent a lot of wasted time in looking at soccer gambling in Macau, where we were given a bum steer that Carson was a key figure. And we found not a shred of evidence to support that. So these theories about what he wanted to do with the club, there's absolutely nothing to suggest he was anything other than a poor businessman in the price he paid, and but a genuine football fan.
Anyone else?
Mr. Reading. What a pleasure.
When you were talking about... Sorry, Kevin, you had something to say.
I just said the persecutor has a question.
You didn't answer the question that Will posed at the beginning. Why did Carson give evidence, Kevin?
Yeah, I was going to raise that. Let me set the scene. Sorry. Carson, as the defendant, obviously had an option whether to give evidence on his own behalf. And at the beginning of the trial, he plainly had decided he wasn't going to give evidence on his own behalf, and he was going to make the prosecution prove their case, and then he would produce his own witnesses, but he wouldn't go in the box himself. Anyway, it was coming up towards half time. I think the evidence was almost closed, and sorry, full time, not half time. And Kevin came on the scene and gave Carson an opinion, and perhaps you can give us some background, Kevin.
The situation normally is in a criminal trial that the ignorant defendant doesn't have a bloody clue whether he should give evidence or shouldn't give evidence, so he relies on those who are representing him to give him sound advice as to whether he should or should not give evidence. I was not part of the defence team when that stage was reached. As a result of no doubt a multitude of factors, including perhaps the advice he was given, he elected not to give evidence. However, he, some weeks later, approached Andrew Lam, another famous legal figure in Hong Kong, and who was an old friend of his, and effectively said, "Did I do the right thing?" And Andrew said, "Well, I'll ask Egan, because he says he knows everything, and I'll get an opinion from him." So that's what happened. I wrote an opinion, and obviously I'm not at liberty to disclose the contents of the opinion, but the effect of it was, I can't guarantee that you will be acquitted if you do give evidence, but I can guarantee you will be convicted if you don't. And so on the basis of that opinion, he entered the witness box and did his best to remember what happened in the last 14 years without the benefit of too many records, and was soundly criticised for not being very good on the memory front.
And that's another criticism of this law, because it forces the defendant in these circumstances to try to give it, the law doesn't say the defendant has to prove his innocence, but the way the law has been interpreted, he inevitably has to try and give an explanation of his conduct, even though the law doesn't say so. So we would call that the reverse onus, and there are reverse onuses written into laws like Section 10 of the Prevention of Bribery Ordinance, but that's a specific reference to a reverse onus. Here, the reverse onus is there because of the way the judges have interpreted the law. And Graham Harris had a different name for it. He called it the tactical onus.
Mr. Reading?
Thank you. Yes. Will, you seem to be suggesting that Carson Yeung was in the same position as the little old lady from wherever it was, Aberdeen, and the other young man from China. On what do you base that?
Well, I'm not saying it's specifically the same category, but there's no doubt that there were many depositors in the accounts, and no one knows where that money came from and whether it was Carson's or not. I mean, he tried his best to give an explanation of the funds. As I say, those people have never been, as far as I know, they were never arrested until Graham Harris's list was handed up. Perhaps you can tell us different, John.
Anything more, Mr. Reading? Okay. The gentleman at the front again, then.
Hi, this is again for Daniel, mainly because you're not a lawyer, and therefore you can speak openly. Was Yeung approached by Keith Harris or Peter Panu as a kind of intermediary, in your opinion?
Oh, for buying the club?
Yeah.
Keith Harris approached Carson Yeung.
Direct.
And introduced Carson Yeung to David Sullivan. Interestingly, when Carson Yeung actually came back to buy the club in 2009, Keith Harris was no longer involved. Seymour Pierce had been dumped, but they'd neglected to terminate the contract, and Seymour Pierce successfully sued Carson for £2 million in success fees.
And he said, "I'll pay that because I got lots
of money." He had no choice. They got a charge on the shares. but he never terminated the contract, which again would indicate that Carson wasn't the most astute of businessmen.
Okay. And the test of a fit and proper person, whatever, was that under Championship rules or Premiership?
Premier League, but they're both the same.
I thought they were different because
no.
Peter Ridge, didn't Ken Bates have this issue with at Leeds? And he was almost getting worried about being promoted?
I don't understand so, but no, the rules are exactly the same.
Okay.
We've time for one more question. I see a number of hands. I think we've got time, if everyone would like to take... Could I see those hands again, please, for who's got questions? I see one, two, three, and I saw one here as well. So we got four more questions, and that would take us probably a little bit past two, but if the speakers are happy and the audience is happy, maybe at 2 o'clock people who need to leave can leave. But I think we're all kind of taking half day off anyway today, aren't we? Okay, so we'll go in order, starting with the gentleman there and then round with the four questioners. Thank you. Could I also suggest maybe we take two questions and then respond, and then the final two questions and respond? Thanks.
Hello, I'm Peter Mills, a partner of Mr. Giles, so I have vested interest in this book. Now that the, perhaps Will or Kevin could answer this, now that the case is about to be lifted from the Stygian darkness of the district court, do you think Carson has a chance of getting a fair trial further up the pecking order?
Then the second question before the response. Second questioner was this one gentleman here.
You mentioned earlier that it was Carson still the owner of the shares. Isn't this proceeds of a crime? And if so, will there be any intention to get it back?
Yeah.
Can I deal with the second question first, and then maybe Kevin can deal with the appeal point? Yes, there are proceedings on foot to confiscate Carson's ill-gotten gains, if you like, and there's a restriction on his assets, including the shares in the club. But of course, pending the appeal process, that those proceedings cannot come to fruition.
To answer the first question, in the context of the present case, there are three tiers of courts that are relevant. The district court, single judge; the court of appeal, three judges; the court of final appeal, five judges. The district court is supposed to operate on the time-honored basis that the prosecution has to prove their case beyond reasonable doubt, and if there is any doubt, the defendant gets the benefit of it. The reality is, in the district court, and there are no juries in the district court, and it doesn't apply to all judges, just most of them. What the reality is that the prosecution witnesses will be believed, and the prosecution case will be accepted, and the defense witnesses and the defendant will be disbelieved, and the defense case will be rejected unless the defendant can prove to the comfortable satisfaction of the court that good reasons exist for why he shouldn't be convicted. And you might think, like I do, that turns the traditional test on its bloody head. No one will ever acknowledge that, but that's reality. We then go from the district court to the court of appeal. And those of us that have the misfortune to go there refer to it as the court of no appeal. And then beyond that, eventually you find your way to Battery Path, where you find the court of final appeal, which is like a gleaming light on the hill where you've got a fair chance. That's the answer.
If I'm just come back to the second point briefly, as my colleague Will said, the shares that Carson owns in the club are under the restraining order. Curiously enough, Carson has actually sold some of his shares between his date of conviction and now, but I'm not entirely sure where the proceeds went, and that's something that maybe the DOJ could answer. Furthermore, as you might have heard me mention, there was a debt of 184 million Hong Kong dollars. BIH had to novate that debt, whereby they took it as debt to themselves rather than to the club, and then exchanged that for equity, giving Carson some 6 billion conversion shares at 3 cents apiece, I think it was. Now, obviously, those shares haven't been converted, because if he took on 6 billion shares, he would own the club and more outright. And there are various rules that stop that. But those shares, curiously enough, do not appear to be under the restraining order that I can see from having looked at it. So again, I would say that that might be a question for the DOJ to answer, because it's possible that Carson could convert those shares and actually be in control of the club with shares that are not under the restraining order. I don't know.
Thanks, Daniel. We'll just quickly take the two final questions and then wrap up. There was one gentleman at the back. And if anyone needs to leave now, this might be a good time while we take these final two questions.
Daniel, you say you're a fan of Birmingham City and that fans like you are revolting, although not yet tear smoked, as we say here. But that rather implies fans are entitled to a fairy godfather to buy them possibly underperforming superstars. You're presumably at Birmingham City, you're managing with journeyman players, youth players and so on. Isn't that actually something that a real fan could get behind?
Well, Will, obviously, as you agreed, you've said a lot of controversial things. And you keep saying, well, let's look at the sources. And you yourself say that four or five of these depositors into Carson Yeung's accounts were dubious people. What do you expect someone that's put money into that account to say if indeed money laundering is going on? Oh, yes, we were money laundering with Carson, or we were put up to it by someone else to send money to Carson Yeung. We don't know what the source of the money is ourselves. They're not going to say that. And it's rather naive to suggest that one can look at sources and ever trace sources in that manner.
Well, I don't think it's naive at all. All we're asking for is a fair crack of the whip. And those investigations should be done with due diligence and the same expedition as the investigation against Carson. He's the easy target. Why can't the depositors face the same rigorous investigation? That's all we're asking for.
On the other question?
I'll answer. If I can come to the other question, this football fan doesn't want a fairy godfather at all. I'm a big believer in transparency and honesty, especially in football. And all I want is someone who owns the club, who's going to have it in its best interest, who's going to run it as a business, which doesn't mean paying massive amounts of wages to players at all. Someone who's going to not rip the fans off, as I'm sure my friend West Ham will confirm, our previous owners did. I'd like to see fan ownership in football, but I think that might be a bit of a pipe dream at the moment. But in answer to your question, you know, at the moment, yeah, we do have journeymen, and yeah, we do have young stars coming through, and that is what football should be about. You're right, it does stick in the craw, because 3 years ago we won our first major trophy ever. We was our first time in Europe for 50 years, and it's a bit of a slide, but that's the way it goes. All I want is a return to not having to worry that my football club is going out of business because of some guy who's in a Hong Kong prison cell and we don't even know what he did. We've got football fans in Birmingham who still do not understand why he's in prison. That can't be right.
Well, I hope you'd thank you very much again, everyone, for coming in on this Typhoon Signal 3 day. Thank you very much, Daniel and Will, for a fantastic talk. And please, a round of applause for them.